In that reading, you heard Jesus talking about how the Father is in him and he is in the Father. And so when we see him, we actually get to see God. When we get a better idea of what Jesus is like, we get a better idea of what God is like, because Jesus is totally man and totally God. And so what we're doing all throughout this series, The Jesus I Never Knew, is looking at some of the really human parts of him. The negative emotions. We've looked at anger, and Amber had an amazing message on that. Tiana talked on loneliness last week. Jesus experienced loneliness too. I talked on sadness a couple weeks back, and if you missed those, you can check those out on our YouTube channel. I hope that you'll go be blessed by those. But we're taking your questions, and the format of the question is, what would Jesus do about fill in the blank? And of course, you could put in anything like a situation that you're in or a social issue, and we have a lot of them coming in. So Tiana has all of the questions, so she's going to field the questions for us, and then we're just going to do our best to do a biblical response. So should we just dive right in, Tiana?
Let's dive right in.
What's our first question?
Okay, so our first question is, what would Jesus do about fake friends?
Who wants to go first?
I don't care.
All right, Amber, you're up. You go first.
What would Jesus do about fake friends? I think Jesus would find, so Jesus is always rooted in love, so I think Jesus would obviously see the good in them. I think if their behavior was not super kind to you, Jesus would probably kindly speak truth to them in regard to that. And you can also love people and have friends with people, but you don't have to be super close to them. Like, I have family members that I love dearly, but I love them from a distance, and I pray for them from a distance. So I absolutely think that it can be done that way.
Yeah. The only thing I'll add to that, too, is Jesus had his disciples, and he was obviously with them a lot. Those were his closest friends, and not perfect people by any means, but they were real because they didn't have any choice other than to be real. The fake people, when you look at Scripture, are the religious Pharisees. So there's fake people that are just like fake friends, and then there's fake people that are like fake religious friends or fake religious people. That's like they're hollow. And Jesus had some pretty harsh words for them, but it was because he loved them and wanted to restore relationship with them. And so were they disciples? Well, some of them became disciples eventually, but many of them, they just were too fake to actually have an ongoing relationship with him. In fact, they ended up killing him. Ironically, Jesus died for their sins. And so Jesus, he was friends, a friend of everyone, but there were some people he let really close, other people that he knew they were fake.
Those are great answers. I don't think I have anything to add to that, but let's go on to the next question. What would Jesus do about anxiety?
Oh, okay. So one. Jesus tells us so many times in the Bible not to worry, and I think he tells us that because he knows we're going to worry because we're human. But I think if you are struggling with anxiety, one, obviously prayer is a phenomenal thing. There's nothing wrong with praying. However, God does put people like doctors and therapists, psychiatrists, psychologists in our lives to be able to help us with those things. So I think number one, praying about it is super important. Scripture tells us not to worry because God's got it. The people that he puts into our lives, utilize them, doctors, medication, psychologists, therapists. But I think also there's just something to be said, and I'm going to say this because I struggle with anxiety. There's something about, I use this quite frequently, I hear you, I see you, I will not partner with you. Because a lot of times I can feel sad, or I can feel angry, or I can feel many types of ways, but our feelings are not facts. I can feel anxious, but it's not necessarily a fact, if that makes sense. So therefore, I think it's important just to know that just because you feel a certain way doesn't mean you have to partner with it. You don't have to carry anxiety along with you everywhere. And I think it's important to share it with people too. That way they're sharing in their your burden with you.
Yeah. What would you add, T?
I also struggle with anxiety. I think we're just some anxious homies up here.
I also struggle with anxiety, by the way.
But what I really learned about it is just one, being vulnerable about it really helps, and being vulnerable about it with God, like I talked about last week, just being really real with God about your feelings and saying them out loud, it really does help. It doesn't solve everything, but it just like it's like one step to healing. It's like one admitting that you have anxiety, because I remember when I first like even admitted it, I was like kind of ashamed of it, and I was like really embarrassed about it, and I was like, I did not quite understand it. And it's like, as soon as I started talking to God about it, it kind of released that shame that I carried from it. And like, it helped me like not worry as much. I don't know why. I don't know why it did that, but that's what it did for me. And also, I think Jesus would go to therapy. I mean, I don't know for sure, but like...
He went to his Heavenly Father for sure. Like, yeah. In the garden before he was going to be crucified, he was praying and an anxious mess. And in fact, there's this this thing that happens in the human body if you have an extreme... It's rare, but if you have an extreme amount of anxiety, you'll actually sweat blood out of your pores. And the scriptures say that Jesus was experiencing that in the garden. And he said, Father, if there's any other way to take on the sin of the world, can we do that instead? Take this cup from me. And so I think it's okay to be real with God and to not be ashamed if you need help. I go to a therapist because it's healthy for me.
I think we all do.
Do we all do it?
Yeah.
And I've taken anxiety medication that has helped me because my brain got sick. I'm not ashamed to take medication when I need, you know, an antibiotic. But what about when a different part of my body is sick? But what about when my brain is sick? I got some help. And God blessed us with that, and it's a glimpse of heaven to be free from that. And so if you feel shame that you deal with anxiety, or you hear, don't worry about tomorrow, and you think Jesus is mad at you for having anxiety, he's not mad at you. He wants to bring you freedom and healing. And so come to him.
Amen. That was good.
That was really good.
That was good.
Glad someone asked that.
Yeah, me too.
I needed to hear those kinds of things, especially when I was younger.
Yeah. What would Jesus do about divorced parent drama?
That's a good one.
A really
I have divorced
one.
Parents. Do you guys have divorced parents? Okay. So I have divorced parents, and a couple of my parents, or one of my parents has been married twice and divorced twice. And so I've seen a couple sets of it, and then as a pastor, I get to see it happen like just in life, in the life of the church and the community. I'm assuming if there's a student submitting this question, what would Jesus do about if his parents were divorcing or something like that? So I think the thing that he would do is he would be able to, because he's God and he's perfect, I'm still working on this, maybe you are too, I think he'd be able to separate the difference between what are the things that he can control as a child in the situation, as a son in the situation, and what are the things that he can't? What are the parts of the story that he actually is aware of? Now, it's unfair because he's God and he knows everything, but we are not. So if he actually had limited knowledge, I think that, but like total control of his emotional abilities, right? I think that he would be able to say, okay, this is what I know and this is what I don't know. It could be this, it could be that. They might be telling me this part of the story, not that part of the story. And so as someone whose parents have divorced, and then I saw another one of my parents be divorced again, I just want you to know, I know that that's awful. I know what it does to a family. I know how common it is. The divorce rate is very high. And it has been getting better in the last few years in terms of numbers, but also the number of people getting married has also declined. So the divorce rates have declined, marriage rates have declined, and some people say, oh, well, that means marriage is the problem. It's actually not marriage that's the problem. It's people that have relationships, marriages, dating relationships, friendships, that they put before God. And that sometimes when you bring a relationship like a marriage to God, it doesn't mean that it's going to work out. So there's some tough situations like if there's abuse or adultery or all sorts of things where a vow is broken. And the scriptures say that those marriages, that they don't have to part, but they can. The other ones that are other things that could need to be worked through, those things are important for them to work through. But here's the deal. If you're not their therapist and you're not their God, your job is to love them. It's to love them. And that doesn't mean it's to be a doormat. It doesn't mean it's to just let them treat you or treat your parent or talk to you about your parent in negative ways. I think that's one of the more unhealthy things. Or to try to get you to side over here or over there. It's important for you to start to recognize, what are the things that are healthy and unhealthy about my parents? because maybe you grew up like me, where for many years you believed that your parents were pretty darn perfect other than they bugged you. And then you started to see that their sin shows up in other people's lives. And that's a transition. And your job is to love people who are broken, including your parents. So I know that that's really big and really broad. I really want to encourage you, because we could talk about that for a long time. I really want to encourage you, if you ask that, I'd love to talk with you. So if you're here tonight, or if you're online, you just shoot us an email, and we can connect. We can talk more about your specific situation, too.
That's good.
That's really good. Thanks, Nick. Okay, what would Jesus do if it was his senior year and COVID hit and everything was canceled? How would he find joy?
I was going to say he'd heal it. You know, he's already here. He'd just be like, be gone, COVID, you know.
I know, right? I wish that was the case.
Next question submitted. Why doesn't he just do that, right?
Seriously,
that's a real question, too.
I think Jesus would try to find the joy in the little things, the fact that you still have breath in your lungs, the fact that you still have food on your table, the fact that you are in a house that's warm and it's cold outside. Like, I think being super intentional and having, like, a book every single day where you write down. So what I do is I have, like, take the alphabet, so I'm on B. So I find all these things that start with B that I'm grateful for, because you can't be grateful and have any negative emotion with that. And so I think in hindsight, like, when you look back, it's going to be epic. You're never going to forget your senior year and that everything was canceled. You're never going to forget that. But what's really important is, like, you have your family around you. You have your friends around you. Yes, your dances are not the same and your games are not the same. But I think, if I'm being honest, God has continued to allow this to happen because we've been so distracted with all those things that we have forgot to spend time with him. Like, we have forgot to be intentional with the person that created us. So that'd be my response.
Yeah, I actually saw a quote on Instagram. I had to pull up my phone for it, that I saw today. And while I don't fully believe in this quote, like, so don't take me word for word for it, I do think there's some truth in it. And it says, plot twist, 2020 has actually been the best year of your life because you've faced challenge after challenge, you've adapted, and you've overcome. 2020 has forced you to grow exponentially, and don't take the little things for granted. Now, I know that you can hear that, and you can say, well, my grandma died of COVID. This has definitely not been the best year of my life. But the thing is, with 2020, I think all of us have grown exponentially, and that's what stuck out to me in that quote today, was, like, I've had to, like, actually slow down in life, and I've had to look at life through a different lens this year, and there has been something really amazing about that. And while I definitely wouldn't have chosen this year to happen, there's so many things that I'm going to take out of it that's going to be something that's helped me grow into the person I am for the rest of my life. And I'm going to take tools that I've gotten this year out into the world once we're able to, like, be normal again. And, yeah, I mean, this year has definitely been a huge bummer. But there's, I think, like Amber was saying, if you find, like, the little things, or you find what you can be grateful for in it, like, it's going to be a season that won't be so bitter one day.
Yeah, I like what you said. It's like, yeah, Amber said, this is a bummer. Like, to be honest and say, yeah, this sucks. This is not good. You know those people that, like, they are totally positive, like, 100% of the time, and you're just like, how are you always so positive? And then you're like, I just wish I could be more like them, is really what you're thinking. I think that some people can do that because they're faking it to make it through. Other people do that because they actually have this joy that's really deeply rooted in Christ. One person that comes to mind for me is actually Justin Stofa, if you know him. He is one of the most positive people that I know. And like, even if, like, think it's a terrible day, he's talking all the time about how he's so blessed and the things that he's so excited about. And so it's easy to brag on him because exudes this joy that exists in the middle of the trial. And so I want to encourage you, if you're like, yeah, it sounds like that, you know, just saying, hey, perk up, buttercup, because Jesus loves you, if that feels like it's minimizing the issues that you're going through, I just want you to know that that's not at all what it is. I want to encourage you, if you're kind of feeling this question a bit, I want you to read the book of James. The book of James. God has been speaking to me in ways through this book in the last week than he has maybe in weeks and weeks prior. I've just been like, oh, Jesus, this is like the book for the people in the pandemic. So get the book of James. It was written by Jesus's brother. What would it take for your brother to convince you that he's the Son of God? It took a lot, resurrection for James. Read that. He's writing it to people that are in a ridiculously similar situation to us. And so I want to encourage you to read that, and you're gonna get an even deeper answer into why, not why even, but like how do we respond in the middle of a trial like this.
Okay, so the next one is, what would Jesus do about the LGBTQA community?
Mm, that's a good one.
Love them.
Yeah.
Give them hugs. Hang out with them.
Yep.
Yep.
I don't think there's much more to add to that. Like, our job is to love everybody, and that's exactly what Jesus did.
And I do want to add something to that, though. Because I know that there's somebody here or somebody watching online or watching this later that's going to say, yeah, he would love them, but wouldn't he also wag a finger at them and tell them that they're sinners? Well, he could do that to everybody, every single person, for a whole host of reasons. And when you look at the Gospels, you don't really see him doing that much, except for to the religious people that wanted to wag fingers at people. So I just want you to know, if that's rising up for you, be careful. Be careful. With the most sincere love of my heart, be careful if it's rising up. But isn't Jesus condemning someone who's a sinner? Do you remember that time that Jesus had this woman that was caught in adultery brought before him, and they said, shouldn't we throw stones and condemn her? He said, okay, first one of you that doesn't have a sin, you throw that stone. And the only person that could do it was Jesus. He could have thrown a stone and condemned her for her sin because she was caught in the act of adultery. But he didn't. He had grace. And so if we're Christians and little Christs, we get in the way of bullies and people in the LGBTQ community. We invite them to church. We ask them to use their gifts to serve. Because they're imperfect just like all of anyone who's not in the LGBTQ community. But they are a beloved human being that is made in God's image and invited to be God's child through the grace and love of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus does not have to do away with any part of the scriptures to be able to love like that. And so while that might seem challenging and difficult in a time like this, our job as Christians is to find that tension together. So I don't want to, I could like talk on that one for like a whole number of minutes. But again, I think I said this earlier, if that's you in some way or something's rising up in you about this, let's talk one-on-one. I think that's one of the best ways to get the conversation going. We don't want to shut a conversation like that down. We want to continue that conversation because God's love is for you. God's love is for the people that you are wondering about. God's love is for everybody.
Okay, this one's kind of heavy. Someone asked, what would Jesus do about sex offenders?
Yeah, so raise your hand if you've seen The Shack. Anyone? Some of you? So a person that may abuse someone sexually is also God's child. And so when you look at that, yes, God's not happy about that. God is angry with that because that is a sin. So God is angry with that behavior, but God still loves that person because that person is still his child. However, we live in a world, and so when somebody does something like that, there are consequences to that. And God wouldn't be a loving father if we didn't have consequences to our actions, correct? So yeah, that's my portion, if y'all wanna say or speak any more on that.
I just think Jesus, he loves everyone regardless of whatever we do. And I think that when we repent of our sins, like, God's got us, and I'm not saying that that excuses anything. It does not excuse anything, but God would love them. Doesn't mean that you forget what they did, but I think God would love them.
I remember talking with somebody once that said, I don't know if I want to go to heaven if that person who abused me is there. Yeah. And I think I really I don't understand that sentiment because I haven't lived that person's life. But I think the logic behind what they're saying, I think I get that. I think I understand why they would say that. And it's interesting because Jesus, he talks about the role of forgiveness. And oh man, when someone's been violated like that, or someone you love has been violated in that way, forgiveness is, it's so much harder and so much more important. Because hell enters into, in the same way that God wants to bring heaven to earth, hell enters into earth through sin like that. And it doesn't just happen in the act. It happens in all of the aftermath and the unforgiveness that poisons and poisons and poisons. And you've heard the phrase, hurt people hurt people. You know the statistics. Those who have been abused are very likely to also, statistically speaking, be abusers. And so Jesus, I think, to put it as plainly as I can, Jesus would die for the sex offender to be made new.
Preach.
And to be transformed and to be given new life. Not just to say, you know what, let me just sweep your offenses under the rug. By the way, Jesus never sweeps any of our offenses under the rug. If you're not in the sex offender category, okay, all offenses are not swept under a rug, they're nailed to a cross, okay? God took every sin so seriously that his son had to die for it. And so if you wanna know how God thinks about the person you love who's abused, or maybe you who were abused, I want you to know that he's willing to die so that there would be justice carried out for the injustice that was done to you or the person you love. If you are an abuser or an offender, I want you to know that he died so that you could be made new and transformed and set free. That's what I got to say about that. That's a heavy one.
That is a really heavy one.
That's a very heavy
that's
one.
That's a really...
And this has been a heavy series.
It really has
because
been.
Because it's a heavy time and a lot of emotions, and these are the questions that are on your mind, right?
Yeah. So thank you guys for being brave and submitting these. We have gotten a lot of questions actually talking about things that we shared in our series. We got questions on anger, how to handle grief, how to handle loneliness. And so if you missed any of the last 3 weeks, all of those messages are on YouTube and you can check them out. If you have questions about them, please reach out to us and we'd love to talk with you more about those. But for the sake of time, because I know we're running short, I've got a few more questions here. And the next one is, what would Jesus think about dreams? Like, I think having dreams, like not like sleeping dreams, I think like dreams for your life, I'm pretty sure.
I don't know. There's a lot in the Bible about like dreams too.
That's true.
I don't know.
We could talk about both.
Yeah, for sure.
Why not?
Yeah.
I think I'm not going to talk on the sleeping dreams because I don't.
Yeah, me neither.
I'm not going to hit that. But the other dream, I'll leave that for the pastor. The other dreams, I think God gives you desires of your heart, but I also think this too. Maybe your dream is to have a $1 million mansion and to have a Lamborghini and a smoking hot significant other and whatever that may be. I'm not saying that can't happen, but is that God's plan for your life? The closer you get with God, the scripture that talks about God wants to give me the desires of my heart, the closer you get with God, the more that your heart aligns with his desires for your life, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So I think that... God loves you and God cares about you and God wants to give you everything in abundance. But I think he has a plan for your life too. And when you don't consult God, use myself for example, I went to school for something that, yes, I learned a lot, but I will never use that ever because God called me to ministry. But I never asked God if this is what I should do. So to be clear, maybe develop a relationship with God and ask him before you spend all of your parents' money at college or your own. I have a degree to be a hospital administrator and to run a hospital, and that's what I thought I would do. But I'm not, and I'm here.
Instead, you
hanging
help
out with
run
all
a hospital
you.
For sinners.
Yes.
Yeah, you know,
yes.
Like the or hospital for sinners and saints. I don't know. What is that, Christianese?
Yeah.
Anyway.
I'm actually reading a book on dreams for the future. It's called Dream Big. It's by Bob Goff, and that book is amazing. Because it talks about like how like at different times in your life you have different dreams or ambitions, And some of your ambitions you end up following and other ones you don't. And sometimes that's just because as you get closer to God, like other ones kind of start to fill your heart more and the other ones start to fade. Or sometimes you just are like, I don't have a desire for the, like to ride a motorcycle anymore. I don't know, like maybe that's one of your ambitions. And so like they just change, but it gives you some really good structure as to how to actually like chase your dreams with God by your side. And so if you are looking for like, how do I actually chase my dreams and do my dreams actually matter? Yes, they do. And I just encourage you, go get the book, Dream Big, Bob Goff, and like there's some really good like exercises in there as to how you can actually like put the work in to like reach your dreams. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I love that. There's a book that we actually did as a series of many, many moons ago at Hope called The Dream Giver. It's a really short book. I know you don't want to read a book. I don't know. Are there any book people here? Are there any book people in the house? Okay.
Yes,
all right.
Penguin.
All right. There's some book people
okay,
in the house.
Guys. I thought there was.
By the way, if you have the ability to read, you are in a small percentage of the human race throughout all of history. So use that gift, and especially towards your faith. So this book, in the book The Dream Giver, basically the whole premise is seeking God's dreams for your life, which is what Amber was talking about, and dreaming big. But it also talks about kind of like the different challenges that you come up against. So just when you run into roadblocks, what do you do with that, and how do you interpret that? Quickly, on dreams that are not like just your aspirations for the future, the dreams like that maybe while you're asleep at night and then your teeth fall out, that means you're probably anxious, by the way, in case you didn't know that. Mm-hmm. But all throughout the Bible, whenever someone has a weird dream and they're wondering if God is speaking to them, and he does, by the way, he does speak through dreams and a million other ways. All throughout the Bible, people went to the people of God to say, look, I had this crazy dream. What do you think it means? And so if you just decide and act on that dream by yourself, not a wise move. But if you come to your small group leader and you say, hey, I had this weird dream. Can I tell you about it? We'd be happy to talk with you about it and just kind of help discern, is that God? Is that the weird pizza you ate that was 12 days old? You know, which one is it? Or somewhere in between. So anyway, that's what I'll say about dreams.
Yeah.
That was an interesting question. I like that.
The next one is, what about worrying about finding your significant other? I feel like that's something we all have worried about in our lives. Maybe. I don't know.
Some I was worried when I felt called to be a pastor that I'd never marry anyone pretty.
And you did.
And I did. I mean, she's gorgeous, you know? Like, I really like her a lot. So,
yeah.
Michelle's awesome.
I think that's something that a lot of people struggle with. Like, I'm the only single one up here. I'm one of the only single one of all my friends. And sometimes that can feel really isolating because you're like, why has no one picked me? And it can be like such a bummer. But the thing is, I think a lot of people just put a lot of pressure on being in a relationship because, I mean, as wonderful as that is, and I think it would greatly enrich, you know, your life if that's something you desire, there's just so much joy and also like being single. And you might be like, Tiana, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. But like, it's true because like, there's just so many other ways I've like leaned on God and like been able to invest in other relationships that I've had just because I have that capacity in my life. Whereas if I were married, I would have like different, I'd have focus elsewhere. And so I think that there can be like a lot of joy. And I think just focusing on finding what you're dreaming about, finding your own passions in life, seeking God and like running alongside him in that, and eventually the right person will come along. And the timing might not be in your timing. Definitely wasn't in mine. But there you can just find so much joy and peace in that. Like once you like let it go and just give that to God and be like, okay, it's just you and me.
And I got to say too, Tiana, that's like super Christ-like because when you think about Jesus, he didn't have a significant other.
Yeah.
He died when he was about 33 years old, and that's a lot of people got married before then. So I wonder if people would be like, is Jesus ever going to settle down and find himself a woman? And you know, like he probably had a lot of those same social pressures. And being Jewish, religiously speaking, getting married so you could have kids was one of the ways that you proved that you were faithful to God. And so because he wasn't doing that, of course he was being a rabbi, so there was that. But because he wasn't doing that, There was social pressure. And so if you feel that social pressure, just know Jesus felt that too, that you're not alone in that. And I love what you're saying about like when you let that go, you actually find this true community where you do experience this fulfilling love. That's amazing.
Love it. You have time for one more?
We have time for one more. Do we have time for two more? Oh, come on. We have so many questions. Guys, there's like over 150 questions in here. I've been trying to get through them all.
We might have to do some Instagram stories.
We can do some Instagram stories tomorrow. Okay. This one I thought was really well thought out, so we will close out with this one. What would Jesus do about confused believers? People like me on the fence about whether or not Christianity is all a false concept, like we believe other religions or atheists to be. If I am in this state, like could I be now and I die young, what happens to me? What happens in the situation if Christianity is all true or real? Okay, so to paraphrase, what happens to confused believers, people on the fence, and like what happens if Christianity turns out to be true and real or not real at all?
There was a man that felt exactly the same way. His son, his child was sick and dying, and he was not Jewish, and so he was kind of on the out crowd. He was a Roman centurion. He was in the military, so this is like the oppressor is coming to this Jewish rabbi and saying, hey, my kid's sick. I need help. And you know what he says? He says, do you believe that I can do this? Because faith is a big deal. Belief and faith and trust, that's a big deal to Jesus and God, right? And so he says, do you believe? And the guy says, I believe. Just help me overcome my unbelief. And you know what Jesus' response was? Healing. And in fact, it wasn't just healing. He said, there's only a few times throughout the scriptures where it says Jesus was amazed. What would it take to amaze God? You know, like Jesus was amazed that this guy was willing to have this kind of faith. He is going and he's healing this person. And if you're confused and saying, Jesus, I think I get the concepts, at least most of them, but I need some help. Expect him to show up. Because there's a whole huge difference between knowing intellectual information about God and giving intellectual assent to that as a fact, and actually experiencing God's love, and forgiveness, and restoration for yourself. And I want the second one for you. The first one matters, but I want the second one for you. And if the first one's getting in the way, again, let's have a conversation. That's something that was a challenge for me for a long time, and it led me to look into it and find some answers that were really helpful for me. And so if you're on the fence, my recommendation for you is don't just stuff your doubts. Look into them, and then actually go to experience God. Seek him. Not to intellectually put him in a box, but seek him to experience his grace and his goodness and his love. Open your heart in a vulnerable way to Jesus and expect him to show up. He will. That's what I got to say about that.
Well, cool. I think we're out of time, guys.
Out of time. How many more questions do we have?
Well, there's 163 questions, and I think we got through like 10.
Yeah, okay. Well, here's the good news. We're going to do a lot more Q&Rs throughout the year. Usually we do like one or two. We're doing a lot more this year because this is fun. This is fun. Thank you guys. And can you just like give yourselves a round of applause for just like being brave, asking real questions, and seeking at Jesus. Personal conversations, although they might be scary, are always more transformational than like this strange anonymity. And so if you're ready to do that, we are willing to have a conversation with you with no judgment, only grace and the love of Jesus. And so,
I would say if there's something on your heart tonight and you're like, I didn't get this answer, I'm going to like do something, come talk to us because we want to make sure... you know, that we can be here for you and not just on the stage, but off the stage too. So if there's something super pressing tonight and you want to ask one of us, we are absolutely available.
So let's just close our time in prayer. We're a couple minutes over already. And thanks for, how can you take any of us seriously in our costumes? But Halloween belonged to the church first, so why not? Let's celebrate Jesus and wear funny costumes. But I just want to say a prayer over all of us. Actually, Amber, would you mind? I didn't ask you to do this, but would you mind just praying over us and just sending us out with the blessing of your prayer?
Father God, thank you so much for the hearts of these students and the transparency that they had to be able to give these questions. God, I pray that if somebody is really struggling tonight and that they really need an answer to a question, that they would come forth and they would use their voice. And God, that you would work through each and every one of us to help transform their thoughts or to give them the wisdom and knowledge that you have given us to share. God, I pray that as we step into this Halloween weekend, God, that you would keep us safe, that you would cover us in your hedge of protection, that you would keep us COVID-free. God, as we have all these questions about faith and about life and about the world, I pray that you would draw near to us. I pray that you would show up, as Nick said, for people that are on the fence, for people that are not sure what they believe. God, you transform us and you make us new each and every day. And so we are so grateful and we are so thankful for that. So God, as we step into this weekend, remind us of the love and the joy and the peace that you give to us. We love you so much. It's in your holy name that we say and we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, we love you guys so much. You guys have a great rest of your week. We'll see you back here next week for the start of a brand new series, a new Ignite My Life. And we even have Zoe, our brand new worship leader. So you guys have an awesome rest of your night. We'll see you.
Have a good Halloween.
And if you caught a snowball, don't forget to get your prize.
Yeah, woo! Prizes are out front.
Bye.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an eerie sight. For my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash. From my laboratory in the castle east to the master bedroom where the vampires feast, the ghouls all came from their humble abodes to get a jolt from my electrode.
They did the mash.
They did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
They did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
They did the mash.
They did the monster mash.